एंड लास्ट वन वाज नोटेबल कॉलर। फर्स्ट वी विल हैव द इंट्रोडक्शन ऑफ दिस चैप्टर। हिस्टोरिकल रिसर्च राइटिंग एंड स्टडीज आर कैरिड आउट विद एन ऑब्जेक्टिव ऑफ अंडरस्टैंडिंग द क्रोनोलॉजी ऑफ द पास्ट इवेंट्स एंड देयर इंटरकनेक्शन। व्हाई डू वी स्टडी दिस हिस्ट्री? व्हाट इज द ऑब्जेक्टिव ऑफ हिस्टोरिकल रिसर्च? टू अंडरस्टैंड द क्रोनोलॉजी ऑफ द पास्ट इवेंट्स एंड हाउ दे आर इंटरकनेक्टेड टू ईच अदर। दिस इज अ कंटिन्यूअस प्रोसेस एंड हिस्टोरिकल रिसर्च और राइटिंग और स्टडी दीज आर ऑल कंटिन्यूअस प्रोसेसेस। लाइक इन द फिजिकल एंड नेचुरल साइंसेज द एम्पिरिकल मेथड और कॉल इट एज लेबोरेटरी मेथड ऑफ एक्सपेरिमेंट्स एंड ऑब्जर्वेशन इज यूज टू वेरीफाई द अवेलेबल नॉलेज इन साइंस नेचुरल साइंस और इन फिजिकल साइंस। व्हाट वी डू वी यूज लेबोरेटरी मेथड्स टू चेक आउट एनी। यस नेहा, व्हाई यू आर रेजिंग योर हैंड? तो लेबोरेटरी मेथड इज यूज to verify the available knowledge in natural science and in physical science. This method allows formulating laws that remain true irrespective of the time and space. But in natural science and in physical science, whatever the laws we use, they remain same the according to time and space. Those laws can be tested and proved repeatedly, and these laws, the laws which we use in physical and natural science, they can be proved repeatedly, they can be tested repeatedly again and again whenever you want at whichever place. Now we will see about historical research method. In historical research, it may not be possible to use the method of laboratory experiments and observation. In historical research method, it is not possible to use laboratory method or observation method. This is so because we were not present in the historical time and space, and the historical events cannot be recreated. Why this is so? Because the event which was occurred 200 years ago, 100 years ago, 500 years ago, at that time we were not present there, and so we were not present there, and we cannot create or recreate such kind of event again because it has been happened and it cannot be recreated. So we cannot use such methods like laboratory experiments and observation method in historical research. Also in history, it is not possible to formulate laws that remain true irrespective of the time and space. Also in history, it is not possible that we should apply such laws which can be remain true whether the time has changed or whether the place has changed. Cannot apply such kind of laws because history is the event which has been already passed. To begin, we need an expert. So for historical research, in the beginning or the first thing which we need for doing a historical research is that we need an expert person who knows the language and script of a historical document. We need an expert person who knows the language and the script of any of the historical documents on which we are doing the research. For what purpose? For reading it and to understand its meaning. To read that document and understand its meaning, we need an expert. It is the first thing we need here. Also, the expert can examine the authenticity of the document. Also, what he can do, he can examine the authenticity of that document, whether the document is true or not, original or not. By using criteria such as lettering style, author style of writing, manufacturing date and type of paper, stamps of authority, etc. So how an expert say that the document is authentic or not? For that purpose, there are some criteria. Criteria has been set up for that purpose, and the criteria are given here like lettering style, author style of writing, what is the manufacturing date of that document, or which type of paper is being used, is there any stamp of authority? Whether there is a stamp of the authority on that document. So by these, all these criteria, the expert examines the authenticity of the document. Then such a document is further scrutinized by a historian with the help of relevant historical references. What he does, he does a minute observation of that document with all these relevant historical references. So here we can see historical research method is given here, and then writing of historical narrative. How the writing is being done of the historical narrative. First is collecting historical information. What is the first foremost thing is here is that collecting the historical information and highlighting the processes that lead to historical transition. What changes have been occurred? We have to highlight that one. In carrying out comparative analysis, then what we have to do here, we have to compare the event with other events of the same period. Next is understanding the references regarding time and space of the given historical events, and also various conceptual frameworks used in historical research methods. Understanding the references regarding the time and space, or the place at which place this event was in, occurred at which time, then formulating relevant questions in view of the historical references. What we have to do here now, we have to formulate the relevant questions related to that specific event on which we are doing a historical research. After that, by the answers which you have got of the questions that we have formulated, we have to formulate the hypothesis related to the answers which we have got. And after that is critically examining of various sources of history. Critically, we have to examine these all sources of history. And last is examining relevant references of the available historical information. Examine the relevant references. Are they related to other such events, or the proofs or the evidences which we have got are relevant to the document or not. Now, after that, we have to write a historical narrative. Excuse me, ma'am. Ma'am, can you hear me, ma'am?
Yes, sir.
Ma'am, I'm getting disturbed by this waiting room's message.
You just continue, sir.
Methods of various disciplines are useful in historical research. The different various disciplines are useful in historical research. For example, archaeology, archival science, manuscriptology, epigraphy. Epigraphy means study of inscriptions. Analysis of lettering style, linguistics, numismatics, study of coins. Numismatics means study of coins. And then here is genealogy means study of lineage, etc. So these are some of the methods of various disciplines which are being useful for historical research. And these are the sources of getting the history. So 1.1, that is first point of our chapter, tradition of historiography. We have learned about the historical research method. Critically examining the historical sources and writing the historical narrative. What we have learned now is critically examining the historical sources, whichever are the sources, written sources or oral sources. What we have to do here, we have to critically examine it and then we have to write the historical narrative. The writing of critical historical narrative is known as historiography, and writing such kind of historical narrative is known as historiography. A scholar who writes such a narrative is a historian. A scholar who writes such type of narrative is known as a historian. The historian cannot include every past event in his narrative. In his narrative, he cannot include every past event, each and every event which was been occurred in history, that he cannot include in his writing. This is so because the content gets more and more, and he might be not having the thinking that he should take this point or not. It is totally dependent upon him which point or which event he should considered in his writing. The inclusion and interpretation of historical events by the historian often depends on the conceptual framework adopted by the inclusion or interpretation. Whether we should add or take this event or not to take this event is totally dependent upon his thinking or the conceptual framework which you have adopted. His style of writing is determined by that conceptual framework, and by this his thinking or his conceptual framework adopted by him, it shows his style of writing. The tradition of writing historical narrative, that is historiography, was not prevalent in the ancient societies of the world. Those were not prevalent in the ancient societies, writing historical narrative, which we call it as historiography. First, it was not prevalent, or people used to not give importance to such kind of writing in the ancient societies of the world. However, that does not mean that they were not aware of the historical time or were not eager to know about it. they were not writing or then historiographers, it does not mean that they were not aware of the kind of events or things, or they were not eager to know about it. They were eager and they were knowing all the information which was related to history. Ancient people also felt the need of passing on the stories of the life. What did the ancient people felt? That they should pass on the stories of life from one generation to another generation. And value of the ancestors to the next generation. Ancient communities all over the world used various means like cave painting, storytelling, singing songs, and ballads. Purpose. What the ancient communities did to pass on this information from one generation to another generation, they did open things for storytelling, singing songs and ballads, etc. These traditional means are looked upon as the sources of history in the modern historiography, and these traditional means are now being looked upon as the sources. These are now became the sources of history in the modern historiography. By these sources, we can know about our past. Next point is 1.2, that is modern historiography. Four main characteristics of modern historiography. We can see here that four main characteristics are being given here related to modern historiography. First is, its method is based on scientific principles. The method is totally based on scientific principles, means evidences are being used. It begins with the formation of relevant questions. This method begins with the formation of relevant questions, means relevant questions are being asked related to that specific document or the event on which we are going to write historiograph. Second thing, these questions are anthropocentric. Anthropocentric means, it means that these questions are about the deed. This means work of the members of ancient human society of a particular period. History does not suggest any interrelation between the divine and the human deeds. They does not suggest any of the deeds done by human or divine, means related to God. They does not suggest that there is any interrelation between these two things, divine and human deeds. Third one is, these questions are supported by reliable evidence. Reliable evidence is being provided while giving these answers. Last one is, history presents a graph of mankind's journey with the help of past human deeds. It presents a graph which shows the graph of mankind's journey from beginning to till now. It is said that the modern historiography with above characteristics has its roots in the ancient Greek historical writings. These are the modern characteristics. These four are the modern characteristics, but it has its roots in Greek historical writing. History is originally a Greek term. History is a Greek term. Herodotus, the Greek historian of the 5th century BCE, before Common Era, used it first for his book entitled The History. The term history, which was being first used by the Herodotus, who was the Greek historian of the 5th century, and he gave this name to his book. The name was The History. So then we can see here, do you know, is given the earliest inscription in the Lower museum. You can see the picture of an inscription in the lower museum. The above picture shows a fragment of the earliest inscription. A forward marching file of soldiers holding shields and spears is seen here. What we can see here? File of soldiers. They are holding the shields and spears. And the general is in the front. Who is leading them? The general, army general is leading them. The tradition of recording historical events. The tradition of recording historical events can be traced back to Sumer civilization in Mesopotamia. The names of Sumerian kings and the stories of battles fought by them have been preserved in various inscriptions. In different inscriptions, these battles, stories of battles, or the names of the Sumerian kings are being preserved. The earliest inscription shown above dates back to 4500 BCE. The above picture, we can see the picture of an inscription, it dates back to 4500 BCE. It records a battle fought between two kingdoms. It records a battle which is being fought between the two kingdoms. It is now displayed at the Lower Museum in France. We can, if you want to see this inscription, we can visit the Lower Museum in France. The next third point of this chapter, that is development of scientific perspective in Europe and historiography. How did the development of this scientific perspective took place in Europe and historiography? We are going to see in this point, that is 1.3. Till the 18th century CE, till the 18th century CE, common era. Discussion focused more and more on the objectivity in history and historiography. Prior to the 18th century, all European universities were interested only in the philosophical discourses revolving around divine before starting of the 18th century CE. 18th century CE, what all the European universities, they were interested in only philosophical discourses revolving around the divine phenomena. However, gradually the scenario began to change in 1737 CE. The university was founded in Germany. A new university was founded in Germany named as Göttingen University. This university, for the first time, had an independent department of history. They were having an independent department for history. Later, other German universities also became centers of historical studies. As the time passed, many other universities were coming further for providing the literature to history. Next and last point of this chapter is 1.4, that is notable scholars. The contributions of many scholars are important in the development of historiography. So contributions of many scholars were there and they have contributed a lot for the development of the historiography. The historiography means historical writing. Let us have a look at the contributions of the few notable scholars. So few notable scholars, we are going to see how they have contributed in development of historiography. First one is René Descartes, born in 1596 and died in 1650. René Descartes was the foremost among scholars. They were the foremost, who insisted on verifying the reliability of historical documents by critically examining them. what they insisted that we should amend historical documents. Among the rules given by him in his book, Discourse on the Method, the following is supposed to have a great impact on the scientific method of research. It is given in his book, Discourse on the Method. Never to accept anything for truth till all grounds of doubts are excluded. Until your all doubts are excluded, you should have faith on the any of the government. So first foremost thing here is that we should all clear our doubts, and then only we can say whether the document is true or fake. Next is Voltaire, born in 1694 and died in 1778. Voltaire's original name was Francois Marie Arouche. He was French. He opined that along with objective truth and chronology of historical events, along with objective truth, first thing was truth and second thing was chronology of the events. Along with both these things, what he insisted that we should consider the other things also, like social traditions, trade, economics, agriculture, etc. was also equally important in historiography. Not only the chronology of the events, not only the specifics of the document, but these other aspects such as social traditions, trade, economy, agriculture were also having the equal importance in historiography. It gave rise to the thought that understanding all aspects of human life is important for history writing, for writing history. Only the authenticity of the document or the chronology of the event is not necessary. Each and every aspect of human's life is important for writing history. Thus, it is said that Voltaire was the founder of modern historiography, and because of this thing, they were known as the founder of modern historiography. Next scholar is George William Frederick Hegel, 1770, born in 1770 and died in 1831. Hegel was a German philosopher. He was a German. He insisted that the historical reality should be presented in a logical manner while presenting the history. It should have some logic in it that people should believe that this might have been happened. There should be some logic behind it. To him, the timeline of historical events was indicative of progress. To him, what he believed that the timeline is important. Timeline gives us the information of the events which have been occurred in past or happened in past in a sequence, in a time-wise. He also thought that the presentation of history is bound to change over time as a new evidence would come forth. If we have given a result of any of the document, but afterwards if you have got any new evidence related to that document or the writing which we have already done, but there need to be big changes if we get a new evidence in the future. So we believe that the presentation of history is bound to change. It is going to change according to the evidence we will get in further or future. With Hegel's philosophy, many scholars were convinced that historical methods were not of lesser quality, though they differed from scientific methods. Though they are different. Historical methods are totally different from scientific methods, but then also they are not of a lesser quality. The collection of his lectures and articles is published in a book entitled Encyclopedia of Philosophical Sciences. This collection of his lectures or the articles which are related to historiography are being published in a book entitled Encyclopedia of Philosophical Sciences. His book, Reason in History, is well known. Another book written by him known as Reason in History is also a well-known book. Next thing in your chapter is given, it is good to know this. According to Hegel, grasping the meaning of any event, happens in terms of two direct opposites. Human mind cannot understand the true nature of that event without understanding the opposite. For example, true, false, good, bad, etc. In order to understand the true nature of a thing, one needs to know both true and false. If we want to know a good quality of any of the things, we should also know the bad quality. Or if you want to know the advantage of anything, we should also have information about the disadvantages also before the Hegel. This method of analysis, which is based on opposites, is known as dialectic. And such method, or this method, which was totally based on opposites, is named as dialectic. So what is given in this method, how the theory is being proposed at the beginning, which is called thesis, a theory at the beginning. If we have started this theory at the beginning, it is known as thesis. Then another theory proposed based on the thesis, when another theory is being proposed, which is contrary to thesis, means that is related to thesis, and it is called antithesis. After a thorough logical next scholar is Leopold von Ranke, born in 1795 and died in 1886. Historiography of the 19th century was greatly influenced by the thoughts of Leopold von Ranke of Berlin University. They were of Berlin University. He spoke about the critical method of historical research. They have spoke about the critical method of historical research. He put emphasis on the utmost importance of information gathered through original documents. They put emphasis, they mostly believed on the, or they gave more importance to the information which has been gathered from the original document. He also stated that all type of documents associated with a historical event need to be examined with greatest care. What they insisted that when we are doing the historical research at that time, whichever the document which is associated with that historical event is needed to be examined with the greatest care. He believed that with this method it was possible to reach the historical truth. What did he believe? That with this critical research method we can reach to the historical truth. He criticized imaginative narration of history. What did he do? He criticized it. He did not believe on the imaginative narration of history. He believed only on the original documents or the authentic information. Collection of his articles is published in two books entitled The Theory and Practice of History, and second one is The Secret of World History. Next caller is Karl Marx, 1818, born in 1818 and died in 1883. In the latter half of the 19th century, a new school of thought arose, keeping in view the new thesis formulated by Karl Marx. Karl Marx formulated a new thesis. So, on this thesis, a new school was being arose in the 19th century, latter half of the 19th century. According to Karl Marx, history was not about abstract ideas. It was about living people. It is, according to him, it was not about the abstract idea, the idea which comes in our mind, but it was about the living people. Not only the ideas, but about the living people. Human relationships are shaped by the fundamental needs of people and the ownership as well as nature of prevalent means of production to meet those needs. The accessibility of these needs to different strata of the society may not be equal. Different strata. In the accessibility, if we are having any one thing, and that thing cannot be divided in income or equally divided to each and every one of the society. In the same way, everyone is not having the same status in the society. Different, someone is rich, someone is poor, someone is very poor, someone is of middle class. So in the society, each and every people is not getting the resources in the same way. The accessibility of these means of different strata of the society may not be equal. This inequality causes a division of the society into classes, and because of this inequality, the classes has been, society has been divided into classes, leading to class struggle. And because of that, the poorer or the class which is having lower income is has to fight or do the struggle in his life. According to Marx, human history is a history of class struggle. As the class that owns the means of production economically exploits the rest of the classes. According to Karl Marx, what is there? That if a class owns the means of production, they are having the means of production, but they are exploiting the rest of the classes. Das Kapital, a treatise written by him, is the most referred book all over the world. Next is Annals School. At the onset of the 20th century, a new school of historiography arose in France, which is known as Annals School. Annals School gave a direction to history writing. It gave a direction to writing of history. It was recognized now that history is not only about political events, kings, great leaders, and accordingly politics, diplomacy, and war, but also about the climate, local people, agriculture, trade, technology, means of communication, social divisions, and their psychology, etc. Means it was now not related to one or two concepts or things. It is now related to each and every factor of the human society. In the historical time, the Annals School was started by French historian. This school was started by the French historian and feminist historiography. Feminist historiography means the restructuring of the history from the perspective of women. The writing of Simone de Beauvoir helped in establishing the fundamentals of feminism. She was French. She was French, and by her writing, it was possible to establish the fundamentals of feminism. The feminist historiography emphasized not only on the inclusion of women in history, but also on the rethinking of the male-dominated perspective of history. Previous history was totally male-dominated. These people gave importance to the male ones. It drew historical research to focus in depth on various aspects of women's life, such as their employment, their role in trade union, their family life, etc. In the historical writings, after 1990, women were portrayed as an independent social class. They were given a different social class of the society, independent social class. Next is Michel Foucault, born in 1926 and died in 1984. The French historian of the 20th century. He was the French historian of the 20th century. Michel Foucault brought forth a new concept in historiography. He, in his book, Archaeology of Knowledge, this question can be asked in exam. Who wrote the book, Archaeology of Knowledge? Of that, the prevailing practice of arranging historical events in a chronological order is not right. He drew attention to the fact that archaeology does not strive to reach the ultimate historical truth, but attempts to explain various transactions in the past. With the help of archaeology, it does not give us the or show us the actual condition of that period, but it is just a way to see or to know how the transition in the past have been happening, changes happening in past. Foucault felt that explaining the transitions in history is more important. By archaeology, only we can know the transitions may have happened, but Foucault felt that we should explain this transition in history, how it happened. He called his method the archaeology of knowledge. Foucault subjected the so far unacknowledged areas of historians, such as psychological disorders, science of medicine, prison administration, etc., to historical analysis. Now, what he did, he acknowledged the new areas he was going to do the historical writing, such as psychological disorders, science of medicine, prison administration. Thus, the scope of historiography kept continuously expanding. Writing of histories of various subjects like literature, architecture, sculpture, drawing, and painting, music, dance, drama, films, and television, etc., came into practice. In each and every aspect of human society was now becoming the part of historiography. So this much only was there for today. And students, now we'll end our lecture here. Ma'am, my lecture has finished.
Hello, Yogesh sir. Point of the lecture.
A very good morning to one and all. I'm Priyanka Raghunath Sapkar from Goregaon MPS Municipal Secondary School East. So students, today we are going to revise with the topic of chemical reactions and equations, where we will study about the different chemical reactions. Okay, student. So chemical reactions. So now in chemistry, you have to undergo with different types of chemical reactions. Now, how these chemical reactions happen and what are their types? We should know that, because in standard 10, you are having one of the lessons of chemical reactions and equations. In the exams, you will be given few of the reactions and you have to find which reaction, okay, and how the reaction forms. So first we should know what do you mean by the chemical reaction. So for that we should know the definition of the chemical reactions. So chemical reactions are nothing but the transformation of chemical substances into a new chemical substance by making and breaking of bonds between different atoms is known as the chemical reactions. So here in this case, transformation of one substance takes place into the another new substances. Either they break the bond or they form a new bond with the another element. So likewise, they form or more different atoms, they either make or break the bond and hence they form a new chemical substance. Likewise, the chemical reaction appears. Now here, for example, you can see colorful circles I had drawn here. So with the help of this, you can understand how the chemical reactions form. Now here A and B, suppose two elements are there, and C and D two elements means A and B two elements, they combine to form one compound, that is AB, and C and D two different elements, they combine to form one compound, that is CD. Now when these two compounds, they combine with each other or they chemically react with each other, in that case what happens, you can see the exchange of the circles takes place. That means exchange of the elements takes place here. You can see that the blue circle mixed with the green circle which was having pink circle before. That means B is exchanged with the D. So now in the next compound you can see CB is formed. So that means when AB and CD, these two compounds, they chemically react with each other, totally new compound is formed, that is AD and CB. Then comes how many types of chemical reactions appear. Now here, total five kinds of chemical reactions are there. That is, first one is the combination reaction, then comes the decomposition reaction, then comes the displacement reaction, then comes the double displacement reaction, and then the oxidation reduction reaction, which we can also call it as a redox reaction, where both this oxidation and reduction reaction takes place. So we will see one by one. Now combination, okay. The name itself tells us that here combining of the two either elements takes place, or one compound, or either the combination of the compounds takes place, or the combination of the element and the compound takes place. So in this case, you can see that the left-hand side is the reactant side and the right-hand side after the arrow is the product side. So always remember, in a chemical reaction, there are two sides. First one is on the left-hand side, there is the reactant side, and on the right-hand side is the product side. So in the reactant, what happens there? There are two reactants, they combine with each other. That means A and B, suppose one example is given to you, that A and B, these two different types of elements are given to you. What they will do, they will combine with each other. Okay, they come together and form one different compound, that is C. Okay, so this, so here combination of the reactant takes place. Okay, means whatever things are present in the reactant, they all combine to form one product. So here in this case, for the combination reaction, always remember that in the reactant side, two reactants will be there, and in the product side only one product will be there. So in the exam, if it is asked, different types of reactions are given to you, and if in the reactant side two reactants are present and in product side only one product is present, that means definitely it is a combination reaction where the combination of the two reactants, they form one specific product. So here examples are given to you when carbon and oxygen, okay, they react with each other, so they combine with each other and together they form CO2, that is carbon dioxide. Same way for the nitrogen and the hydrogen, when these two elements, they combine with each other in, when they are in gaseous form, so that G in the bracket, that shows the gaseous form. Okay, same for the carbon, it was written S in the bracket, so here S represents the solid form, and for oxygen, gaseous form. Okay, so here when nitrogen and hydrogen, they combine with each other, they form NH3, that is ammonia in gaseous form. Now here you can see that N2 is given and H2 is given. So according to the rules of the chemistry, this nitrogen and hydrogen, they cannot appear singly. So what happens? They combine with its own elements or with another element. So you will never find any of the element containing only N. Okay, so here N2 will form and H2 will form. So here N2 and H2, when they combine with each other, they gives us ammonia, and this is in gaseous form. Then comes the CaO and water. Okay, so this calcium oxide and water, that means solid and liquid, both they combine with each other and they form calcium hydroxide, that is CaOH2 here in solid form. So here in all these examples, you can see that all the reactants, they combine with each other. That means here no side product is formed in the combination reaction. Always remember one key formula for this combination reaction, that in the combination reaction, there are always two reactants, and in the product side, there is only one product. Then we will see the second reaction, that is the decomposition reaction. Now, as you have seen the combination reaction where the reactant contains two reactants and the product contains one. So here decomposition is the inverse process of the combination method. So here in combination reaction, two reactants were there, whereas in decomposition reaction, two products will be formed and only one reactant will be there. That means it is totally the reverse of the combination reaction. So always remember, decomposition reaction is the reverse of the combination reaction, where the reactant is only one in the decomposition reaction and here products are two. Now, why this happens? Why only one reactant are there? Because if you want to react any chemical reaction, so there should be two reactants. But what happens here? Decomposition means breakdown. So here, that's why if any compound is present, any substance is present, that gets breakdown. So a single reactant breakdowns to form two or more substances. So that's why many compounds, they react in this way when they heat it, when they thermally heat it, or they get by the process of electrolysis also, they get breaks down. So here in this case, you can see the key formula for it is the reactant contains only one, that is C, and it gives the product, that is A plus B. That means here two products are formed. So one of the example you can see KClO3 gives us KCl. Okay, and thrice O2. That means here potassium chloride and oxygen. That means from this KClO3, it gets breakdown to form KCl and O2. Same way, the below one you can see PbCO3. Okay. Here we can get that lead oxide and carbon dioxide, the product will be formed. Same way for the CuOH2, so it's CuO and H2. So that means here the reactant is only one and we are getting the two products. So this is totally reverse process of the combination reaction. So first of again, we will little bit revise the combination reaction. In combination reaction, two reactants are there and one product are there, whereas in decomposition reaction, one reactant is there and two products are formed. So in decomposition reaction, breakdown of the reactant takes place, whereas in combination reaction, combination of the two reactants takes place. Okay. Then comes the displacement reaction. Now displacement, that means here the name itself tells us that here replacement reaction takes place. That means it displaces from one place to another. It moves from one place to another. Okay, displacement means it moves from one place to another. So same case happens with the chemical reaction containing this type of displacement reaction. So in displacement reaction is a chemical reaction in which a more reactive element displaces a less reactive element from its compound. So the both the metals and the non-metals take part in the displacement reaction. Okay, they can be either metals or they can be either non-metals. So they both takes part in this reaction. Now what happens here? More reactive element, it replaces the less reactive element. So for example, the reaction of the iron nails with copper sulfate solution. This is one of the example of the displacement reactions. We will see one by one. Here you can see copper sulfate and iron. Now here CuSO4. Okay, this is blue solution. Okay, so what happens when it reacts with iron? Okay, then what happens? This copper is replaced by the iron, and in the product side you can get iron sulfate and copper is formed as a side product. So here greenish solution, so this blue solution gets converted into green solution. Why? Because this copper is replaced by the iron, and hence we get the product of iron sulfate and copper. Okay, this is the displacement reaction. So displacement reaction can be studied in two types. First comes the single displacement reaction and then comes the double displacement. Now the name itself tells that the single displacement means only one displacement of element takes place. Whereas in double displacement, that means two elements might be replacing. So here we will see one by one. So first of all is the single displacement reaction. Now here you can see a single displacement reaction is a chemical reaction in which one element, a reactive metal or a non-metal, takes the place of an element in a compound to produce another element and the another compound. So here you can see A plus BC gives AC plus B. Okay, so here in this case, when A is a metal, okay, whenever A is a metal, so in that case, metal will replace a metal. But if A is a non-metal, then a non-metal will be replaced by the non-metal only. So here one of the example you can see A plus BC gives B plus AC. So in this case, what we have replaced? We had replaced the B by A. Okay. So that means if B is a metal and A is a metal, then only they will exchange each other. Okay. A metal and a non-metal will not be exchanged. Okay, if suppose for example a metal is given to you and a non-metal containing the another element is given to you, so in that case only a metal can replace a metal and a non-metal can replace a non-metal, but a metal will not replace a non-metal and a non-metal will not replace a metal. So always remember this key point. Okay, so here in this case you can see the example that A plus BC gives B plus AC when A is a metal, and when A is a non-metal, that is A plus BC, then we will get the product as BA plus C. Okay. Now here also you can see it single displacement. Now the one of the most key important factor is that now in single displacement reaction, always remember that the reaction will take place in the reactant side. There will be one element plus a compound. That means there will be reaction between a compound and a element. Now why only one element will be present and why one compound will be present in the reactant side? Because as it is a single displacement reaction and only one displacement will be appearing here, so only one element will replace from the compound and it is replaced by the highly reactive element. So that's why here, if in the exam, if it appears different types of reactions, one of the most key important thing is that if there is only one element reacting with the compound, then most probable that will be a single displacement reaction. So here you can see that BC is a compound and A is the element. So in the reactant side, one element and one compound. They react with each other. And here B is less reactive, so it will be replaced by E. And hence, in the product side, we can get AC plus B. Okay, so this is the reaction. So for example, we can say a single element replaces another element in a compound. So here, for example, when potassium reacts with sodium chloride, then what happened? Potassium is a metal and sodium is also a metal from sodium chloride. So what will happen? And sodium is less reactive than that of potassium. So what will happen? It will be replaced by potassium here. So here KCl we will get and sodium will be appeared as a side product. Same way when chlorine and NaBr, now these are the non-metals. Chlorine is a non-metal and bromine is also a non-metal. Now here sodium is a metal. Now always, now how to find that whether to replace a metal or a non-metal? Whenever the element which is present, that is if Cl2 is there, then if that is a non-metal, then you have to understand that here we have to replace the non-metal. But whereas in the element if it is metal, then you will understand that we have to replace the metal from the reactant. Now here in this case Cl2 is a non-metal and Cl2 it reacts with NaBr. Now Br is also non-metal and sodium is a metal. So as the element is a non-metal, so Br will be replaced by the Cl. So hence non-metal is replaced in the second example. So understand this difference. Okay, in the first example metal is replaced and in the second example non-metal is replaced. So always remember, a metal can replace only a metal and a non-metal can replace only a non-metal. Now we are talking about that the most reactive element is replacing the less reactive element. So how we can understand that which element is highly reactive and which element is not highly reactive? For that, this is one of the chart. Okay, this chart you should understand. Okay, now the below elements, okay, the most below elements is the least reactive element. If these elements are present, and suppose in the element side, in the reactant side, if the most reactive elements which are present on the top, okay, that means here the reactivity increases as we go up. From down to up, as we go, the reactivity it increases. So hence the least reactive element will be replaced by the most reactive element. So here in this case platinum is the least reactive, and suppose with platinum zinc is reacted, so in that case zinc will replace the platinum. Why? Because zinc is most reactive than that of platinum. So likewise you have to undergo this reaction for the single displacement. Okay, so here you can see that platinum is the least reactive, then comes the gold, silver, copper, hydrogen, lead, tin, iron, zinc, carbon, aluminium, magnesium, calcium, sodium and potassium. And potassium is the most reactive element. Okay, now how to learn this reactivity series? Okay, how to remember it? Just you can take the screenshot from this, that how to learn this series, which is the least reactive and which is the most reactive. So for that, one of the to remember it, one line is made, that you can start from upwards, that please stop calling me a careless zebra, instead try learning how copper saves gold. Now this is one of the method to learn the reactivity series. Okay, P stands for potassium, S stands for sodium, Cal it stands for calcium, M stands for magnesium, A stands for aluminium, Car it stands for the carbon, then Z it stands for zinc, I stands for iron, T stands for tin, Le it stands for the lead, H stands for hydrogen, copper same as it is, then comes S stands for silver and gold as it is. So likewise you have to remember the reactivity series. Okay, you can take a screenshot if you want. Okay, now you can see few of the examples. Okay, now according to the reactivity series we will solve these examples. Now here zinc and CuSO4 is given in the reactant site in the first example. Now here you can see. Okay. Now where is the position of the zinc? Now where zebra is written on the right hand side, you can see zinc position is there. And where is the copper position? Below, that is from down last third one. Okay, copper. So that means copper is least reactive than that of zinc. So hence we can replace the copper with zinc. So here ZnSO4 is formed and Cu is made as a side product. Then comes the Al and CuSO4. Now here in this case, where is the position of the aluminium? You can see from the fifth one, aluminium. Okay, for aluminium and copper is below it. That means copper is less reactive than that of aluminium. So hence we can replace the copper with aluminium. In the product side, you can see the answer. Then Fe and CuSO4. Now here in this case, iron is present above the copper. So here in this case, what will happen? Iron will replace the copper. Then Pb and CuCl2. Now you can see where is the Pb here? That is Pb means lead. So here lead is from below fifth one. So here where learning is written, that in front of that lead is given to you. So lead is having more reactivity than that of the copper, because copper is present just after hydrogen, below lead. So here in this case, that means whatever elements are present above that particular element which is present in the compound, so that will be replaced. Okay, so here likewise single replacement takes place. Now one of the most important part is that now you can see that in the single displacement reaction, in the reactant side, only one reactant is present and one product and one compound is present. So always remember, whenever for the displacement reaction, only one element and one compound is present on the reactant side, then that will be your single displacement reaction. Okay. Now that was the reactivity series for metals. If suppose non-metals are present, so that too is have that too they are having the reactivity series of non-metals. So here you can see that we will start from below, because as we move upwards, the reactivity increases, and as we move downwards, the reactivity decreases. So here for phosphorus, okay, the reactivity is very low. Then comes the sulfur, then iodine, then bromine, oxygen, chlorine, and fluorine. So that means fluorine is having the, it is the most reactive element, and whereas phosphorus is the least reactive element. So here likewise, suppose for example, we will take this Cl2 plus KBr. Now here you can see that Cl is also a non-metal and Br is also a non-metal, whereas the potassium, that is K, is a metal. So as metal is not present to replace a metal, so we will consider the non-metal. And also on the element which is present on the reactant side, that is also a non-metal, so definitely we will replace a non-metal. So here from this series, chlorine is having the highest reactivity than that of the bromine. So naturally, if bromine is less reactive, then it will be replaced by the most reactive or the highest reactive element. So here Cl, bromine will be replaced by the Cl. So here in this case, we will get the product as Br2 as a side product and KCl. So likewise, single displacement reaction takes place. Then comes the double displacement reaction. Now double itself tells that there will be two elements which will replace each other. Okay. Now here in the single displacement, only one element was replaced. But whereas in double displacement, two elements will be replaced. Now the definition of the double displacement is a reaction in which there is an exchange of ions between the reactants. They are called as double displacement reactions. Now as you know how ions are formed, whenever suppose for example one compound is given to you, then that compounds break down into the ions. Okay, ions having the charges, either they will have positive charge or they will have negative charge. and what will happen? These charges, they combine with the opposite charges. That means the positive charge will combine with the negative charge and the negative charge will combine with the positive charge. So likewise, exchange of the ions takes place. Okay. So that's why in the definition, what it is given? A reaction in which there is an exchange of ions between the reactants. They are called as the double displacement reaction. So here, for example, if the barium sulfate and the barium chloride is formed from the sodium sulfate and the barium chloride. So here you can see the example that Na2SO4, which we called it as a sodium sulfate, when it reacts with BaCl2, that is barium chloride. Now always just try to understand the difference between the single displacement and double displacement. Now you can see in this double displacement reaction, in the reactant side, that is on the left hand side, you can see that both are compounds. Okay, here Na2SO4, this is one compound, and BaCl2, this is also one compound, because they are formed by the combination of the elements. That's why they are known as compounds. So so first reactant is also compound and second reactant is also compound. But whereas in single displacement reaction, only the first reactant was only one element and the second reactant was compound. Here you can see the difference. Here on the reactant side, that is on the left hand side, the first reactant is element and the second reactant is a compound. That means here in single displacement, one element and one compound, they undergo chemical reaction, single displacement reaction. But whereas in double displacement, on the left hand side, that is on the reactant side, two compounds are there. Okay, so that's why here what happens? Exchange of the ions takes place. That means Na2SO4, it breaks down into ions, and BaCl2, it also breaks down into ions. Then what will happen? After breaking down, the oppositely charged elements, they will combine with each other and they form a new compound, that is sodium barium sulfate and sodium chloride. Now for the double displacement reaction, you no need to take the reactivity series. Reactivity series is only useful for the single displacement reaction. It is not useful for the double displacement reaction. So you no need to see the reactivity series for the double displacement reaction. Only it is useful for the single displacement reaction. Okay. So here you can see that Na2SO4. Okay. Now the sodium and barium, what will happen? They will exchange their position. Okay. So here Na2, that is sodium, will be replaced by the Ba, and Ba will be replaced by the sodium. So here in this case, what product we will get? We will get the product of barium sulfate and sodium chloride. So here in the reactant side, two reactants, and in the product side also two products. So here in this case, this is known as the double displacement reaction. So here with the help of circle, you can also see this, that AB plus CD gives us AD and CD. Here, exchange of ions takes place. Exchange of ions takes place means, here in this case, exchange of the elements takes place. So two elements have been replaced. Okay. First, in the reactant side, A was combined with B and C was combined with D. But in the product side, A combines with D and C combines with B. Okay. Interchange of the groups of atoms or ions. So here, that only example is given to you. So you can see that SO4 replaces and it goes towards the Ba, and Cl2 it replaces and goes towards the sodium. So likewise, barium sulfate and sodium chloride is formed. You can see the arrows which are present, and from the red color SO4 is given, and with the gray color Cl2 and Cl is given. So that shows that how it exchanges, so how double displacement, that means two displacement appears in a single reaction. Then comes the oxidation. Now oxidation, oxygen, whenever addition of oxygen takes place, that shows it is oxidation process. Now oxidation is nothing but the loss of electrons. So during a reaction by a molecule, atom or ion. So here oxidation occurs when the oxidation state of a molecule, atom or ion is increased. Okay, so that means whenever the oxidation state of molecules, atoms or ions increase, that time oxidation it occurs. So the opposite process is known as the reduction. So which occurs when there is a gain of electrons or the oxidation state of an atom, molecule or ion in decreases. So oxidation in short, you can say it is the addition of oxygen. Okay. And here loss of electrons takes place. Okay. As the electron gets lost, so what happened? Positive charge will appear over that particular element. And positive charge shows that it loses its electrons and it is get oxidized. Okay. Whenever positive sign is there above the element. So, but whenever negative sign is there, that shows it gains the electron. That means it gets reduced. So you can say the reduction means gain of electrons. So whenever gain of electron is there, so naturally then you will get the negative charge. So here process of reduction is given to you. It is a chemical reaction that involves the gaining of electron by one of the atoms involved in the reaction between the two chemicals. So here the term refers to the element that accepts the electron as the oxidation state of the element that gains electrons is lower. So an examples of reduction is when iron reacts with oxygen, so forming iron oxide such as those called rust. So the iron is oxidized and the oxygen is reduced. So this is known as the redox reaction. So blast furnace reverses that reaction using the carbon monoxide as a reducing agent to reduce the iron. So this is one of the example of the reduction. You might have noticed that iron when reacts with oxygen, so what happens? It gets rust. So that rust is nothing but it shows that iron is oxidized. Okay. So here, and the iron is oxidized and the oxygen is reduced. So iron itself gets oxidized, but what happened? As it loses electrons, iron loses its electrons and oxygen gains the electrons. So that's why oxygen gets reduced. So hence this process is known as the redox reaction. So here in this case, you can see CuO plus H2. Now what happens here? CuO, it loses oxygen. So as it loses the oxygen, then what will happen? It gets reduced. Okay. Whenever any compound, it loses the oxygen, it is known as the reduced reaction. In that compound, reduction appears. Okay. And whenever any element or compound, it gains the oxygen, then that shows the oxidation, the process of oxidation or the addition of oxygen appears. So here in this case, both the reduction and oxidation appears. Same way for Fe3O4 and H2. So what happens here? Fe3, it loses the oxygen. Okay. And hence what happened? Reduction takes place of Fe. Whereas H2, it adds the oxygen or it gains the oxygen. So here oxidation of H2 takes place to form water. So likewise, both reduction and oxidation process takes place. Then comes the reducing agent and the oxidizing agent. So the substance when reduced, it is known as the oxidizing agent. That means why the substance is reduced? Because it gains the electrons. So it gains electrons, that means the compound with which it is reacting, it takes the oxygen or it takes the electrons from it. So as it is taking the electrons from that particular substance, so that substance will be oxidized. So hence, as these substances are enabling the oxidizing process, so hence they are known as the oxidizing agent. Same way, the substance is oxidized is called as the reducing agent. For example, sodium, when it loses the electrons, you can see electrons are there. So what happens when it loses the electron? It gets oxidized and get the sign of plus one. Okay. And then sodium is oxidized. It is the reducing agent. Okay. So that means now sodium loses one electron. So it itself undergoes oxidation. Why? Because it loses the electron. Then what happens with the chlorine? Chlorine, it gains that only electron. Okay. And hence it gets reduced. That means chlorine is an oxidizing agent. Why? Because chlorine oxidizes the sodium to gain the electron. And why sodium is a reducing agent? Because it gives its electron to the chlorine. So that's why it is a reducing agent. So here one of the example is given to you, that CuO and H2. What happens here? Cu, it loses the oxygen and hence get reduced to form Cu, and H2, it gains the oxygen, hence it is oxidized. Then comes the redox reaction. Now redox reaction means what? Wherever oxidation and reduction both takes place. So these were all the examples of the redox reaction where both the oxidation and reduction takes place. So here you can see oxidation is loss of electron and reduction is gain of electron. So here X is oxidized by Y, then Y is reduced by X. X loses the electron and Y gains the electron. X is a reducing agent and Y is an oxidizing agent. So X increases in oxidation number and Y decreases in the oxidation number. So hence, likewise, reduction and oxidation takes place. So here one of the example is given to you, Cu di positive when it reacts with Mg. Then what will happen? Now Cu di positive, that means whenever we talk about what is the oxidation state of that particular element. Now, oxidation state means what? How many number of positive signs are there? Whether 2 positive is there, 3 positive is there, 1 positive. That means that shows, this positive sign shows how many number of electrons you lost. Now here for Cu, 2 plus is given. That means 2 electrons are lost by Cu. And these 2 electrons, okay. Now what happened here? Now, Cu, it gains the electrons and in the product side, it gets reduced as by gaining the electrons because it was having electron deficient with 2 electrons. So what is done by him? That it gets the electron from the Mg. Now, Mg get oxidized by losing of electrons and hence Cu, it becomes Cu stable and then Mg di positive, having the oxidation state is formed. So likewise, both the oxidation and reduction takes place of this chemical reaction. So in short, we will revise different chemical reactions. Now, if you understand this 5 reaction, it will be easier for you to understand which reaction is what. Okay. So once again, chemical reaction is the transformation of this chemical substances into a new chemical substance by making and breaking of bonds between the different atoms, and it is known as the chemical reaction. Then comes types of chemical reaction. First comes the combination reaction, then comes the decomposition reaction, then displacement reaction, then double displacement reaction, oxidation and reduction reaction. Oxidation and reduction, you can also call it as a redox reaction. For combination reaction, the key point is that just understand the key points. So with the help of that only, you will be able to understand the given reaction is given of which is of which type. Okay. So in the combination reaction, on the reactant side, 2 reactants will be there. Okay. And in the product side, only 1 product will be there. That means here the combination of the 2 reactants takes place and they will form one single product. Whereas in decomposition reaction, it is the reverse of the combination reaction where breakdown of the substance takes place. That means here reactant is only 1, but the product, 2 products are formed. Okay. So that means breakdown of one single reactant to 2 products. Okay. Then comes the displacement reaction where replacement of the elements takes place. So how? In that case, first we study the types of displacement reactions, single displacement and double displacement. So here in single displacement, what happens? Metal is replaced by metal and the non-metal will be replaced by non-metal. When? Now in this case, always remember in single displacement reaction, you have to use the reactivity series chart. With the help of that, whenever any less reactive element is present, so that will be replaced by the more reactive element. Okay. So here you can see the example. Then this is the reactivity series. the least reactive is the platinum and the most reactive is the potassium. Okay. Then this is the reactivity series of non-metals, where the least reactive is the phosphorus and the most reactive is the fluorine. Then comes the double displacement. Now here you no need to look for the reactivity series. Directly here, exchange of the ions takes place. Now here on the reactant side, two different substances or two different compounds will be there. In that, exchange of ions takes place. And after exchange of ions, that means here, two elements, they will exchange with each other. And hence, they will form one different product. So here, the number of reactant will be equal to number of product. Here you can see the example Na2SO4 and BaCl2. Here SO4 is replaced and Cl2 is also replaced. Then comes the oxidation process, where loss of electrons takes place, and hence whenever loss of electrons appears, an addition of oxygen takes place there. So that is known as the oxidation. And what do you mean by the reduction reaction? There gain of electrons takes place. Now here oxidizing and reducing agent, the substance which is reduced, it is known as the oxidizing agent. Just remember the opposite thing. Whenever any substance get reduced, that will be the oxidizing agent. And whenever the substance is oxidized, then that will be the reducing agent. Then comes the redox reaction. Now redox reaction is nothing but the what happens here, oxidation and reduction both appears here. That's why the name is redox reaction, where oxidation also takes place and reduction also takes place. Now here in this case, in this chemical reaction, both the oxidation and reduction takes place. So hence it is a redox reaction. Here you can see Cu dipositive, the oxidation state of Cu is twice positive. So here in this case, what it will do, it will gain the electrons from Mg, and hence Mg will get oxidized and Cu will get reduced. So I hope you understood the topic. Yes.